to smokers. And recently, my Lord Mayor, 23 smokers were found guilty at the Liverpool Magistrates Court due to discarding their cigarette ends. We have to ask, why is this figure so high? And why so disproportionate? Are there adequate facilities for smokers to get rid of the butts? As I believe, we have a responsibility to provide facilities for smokers to get rid of those butts responsibly. Okay. Also, because of the figure being so high, the 12,754, it seems that the city's litter squad are targeting a group of people, and sometimes they have been accused of falsely accusing people of littering. For example, recently there was a video of a lady called Maria McCann who was harassed, embarrassed and intimidated and bullied and followed into a hotel on a day that was quite a sad day for her, really, to be accused by one of these members of the litter squad that she just dropped a cigarette butt, and that lady has never smoked in her life. What I believe... What I believe is we have serious problems in our community. We have flight tickers, we have serious offences of people throwing out waste, food waste from their cars. We have dog mess, and really, I really do think that I've reported to the council, members of the public have reported to the council, and nobody has been fined to date. Are we picking? You know, we need to, the council needs to do its bit, but it shouldn't really just target smokers in the city. It needs to target the whole of the environmental vandalism of littering in our city.
I think you've made your point, Councillor Lawrence. Councillor Croft, very briefly, if you can, because this will be our last speaker.
I will be very brief, Lord Mayor. Just to say that I, for one, am glad that the issue of plastic getting into our wider environment is finally working its way up the news agenda, people's awareness, and we start to do something about it. I think it's really important, and we'll be supporting the motion.
Okay. Can I therefore take a vote on the motion without trying to give people time to get in?
Crisis ran the risk of overwhelming their capacity to deliver. This year could well present precisely the same problems over winter, and this motion explains why, when the government talks on this issue, they talk with forked tongue, both nationally and in particular in the way that Liverpool has been particularly penalised. Lord Mayor, the table shown in the motion indicates the uplift that Liverpool has received through its main funding, NHS funding institution, the Health Authority originally, the PCT, and then the CCG. It is apparent from just looking at this table that in the first financial year that followed the coalition government, that the extent of increased funding fell off a cliff from the coalition government. Effectively, that is because of two things. First of all, the amount of additional resource available for the NHS significantly underplayed health service inflation. Each of those years has seen a health service inflation running nationally at somewhere between 3-4%, and the national increases fell well below that 3-4% figure. So we had a real terms cut to the NHS year on year since the coalition came in. It's no surprise, knowing that our health service is in crisis and deepening crisis every year. But it's even worse than that, Lord Mayor. This council will be entirely familiar with the way in which the funding formula for local government was gerrymandered ever since the Conservatives came in. Tweaks to the funding removed the extra supplements that came to deal with deprivation, and shifted money away from areas like Liverpool to the leafy Tory-run local authorities. Well, exactly the same process, concealed in the complexity of the funding formula, has happened for the NHS. Money's been shifted away from areas of deprivation to areas on a per capita basis. The net effect of that is that the richer areas have done significantly better out of the funding formula reviews. Every year since the coalition came in, the CCG has been on the floor of the level of funding increase. It could not have received a lower funding increase for each of those particular years. The consequence of that, Lord Mayor, has meant that we have seen not just the overall real terms cuts that the NHS has experienced in the country as a whole, but here in Liverpool, we have received the worst extent of underfunding and real terms cuts in our NHS compared to anywhere in the country. The consequence of that is, together with last minute changes in business rules, which prevented our CCG from spending some of the money that it was initially allocated in the beginning of the year, and then we've had unplanned, last minute cuts in discretionary services, which affect some of the services which this council, and indeed all aspects of the NHS, particularly treasure, health prevention, services to children and young people's mental health provision, some of the voluntary sector services. And we have seen increasing demand pressures placed on our hospitals, resulting in an inadequate service. Parts of this year, we've seen ambulances being unable to discharge into the Royal and to Aintree's A&E. But in addition, we've seen increased waiting lists on planned surgery, and we have an inadequate number of GPs in the city to deal with the long-term provision of primary care. Lord Mayor, this motion sets out what can only be the minimum possible ask from the government, which is to say that for a city such as Liverpool, if we had had, we're not even asking for the 4% inflation rise that the King's Fund says is necessary to meet just inflation needs. If you just gave us the average increase that CCGs have had across the country, we would have received an additional £32 million worth of money. Money that is desperately needed here in Liverpool. Money that we could have had, and Lord Mayor, frankly, money that we should have had. I ask this council to be united in sending a single message out to government to say that we will no longer sit by and be confused by any complexity of funding formulas. We need to be properly funded. Our NHS and our city and our people deserve it. Give us back our £32 million. Thank you.
Accepting them without actions. And of course, if we were to leave the motion from Councillor Brant unamended, that's precisely what we would be doing. In the last municipal year, as a result of motions in this council, we sent 27 letters to ministers. What did that achieve? So is that a message to me,
I'm just checking who was second. Oh, sorry,
I'm second.
Right. I thought you'd give me a white card. Even I'm not watching football, I don't know what a white card is. So 27 letters to ministers, we didn't get a penny as a result of it. So we are putting forward an amendment which says two things. The first is actually to agree with the chief executive of the NHS, Simon Stevens, who said, if we had more money, the place to use it is firstly in public health, and that's absolutely vital. 10% of our hospital beds are now occupied by people with type 2 diabetes. 99.9% of type 2 diabetes is avoidable if we did the right things in public health. And the second thing he said is, if I had more money, I would put it into adult social care. And at any one time across the NHS, 15% of our hospital beds are occupied by people with no clinical or medical needs. And that's why I congratulate Councillor Brant on the announcement he made last month about the new facilities to get people out of hospital quickly. But let's never forget that 25% of our beds are occupied by people who, for one reason or not, shouldn't be there. So I suggest a firm action. You might think this is a Liberal Democrat plot, but it's to emulate what's happening in Manchester. Proposals for devolution of the health service, which brought in £450 million of new money. Proposed by Richard Leese, the leader of Manchester Council, and now being enacted by Andy Burnham, the Labour Mayor for Greater Manchester, and Lord Peter Smith, the leader of Wigan, who chairs the Manchester Health Partnership. They are making huge and vital changes. And I know, because he said it at a meeting in public that I was chairing, that he, the Mayor of Manchester, has recommended to the Liverpool City Region there that he too ought to apply for the devolution of the health service to us. It's a very simple thing. Do you want to whinge or do you want to do something? My amendment will get you doing something. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Councillor Kent.
And of course, whether that's the right thing or the wrong thing to do, what we're discussing is about funding resources to the health service. And what you're saying seems to assume that there's enough money in between CCG and City Council to deal with the issues of type 2 diabetes and out of social care, but that is painfully not the point. The case that is not the substance of this motion. And of course, you probably would say that because this is your week of your Lib Dem conference. And of course, Vince Cable was in the cabinet when a lot of these changes and funding plans were made, when he was already there. You might wave your hands like that, but there's none of your colleagues there at the end of it to be speaking while you're doing it. But the point is, and it's a serious point, unfortunately, and uncomfortable. uncomfortable that is for you. The Lib Dems were in Cabinet and agreed, not just agreed it, but argued it publicly, took it to the public, to you and me, about how important it was that we made the cuts that we did because there was no alternative. And you brought those arguments to the floor of this chamber. Some of the supposed approaches that were made to ministers were supposed to be what you made to your colleague, Nick Clegg, about the effect it was going to have on the Liverpool City Council. Of course, that didn't work, did it? But I think the important point, what I wanted to say was this, is that when we talk about how we often think, and imagine our own minds still do, with mainly to do with adults, and around the issues of health in winter and the bed blocking and the queues that are in hospitals. But of course it really does affect children. And you can't long term improve the health of adults without focusing and targeting attention on the health of children. I'll just take quickly mental health. The public health report to the Health and Wellbeing Board, they said that 50% of problems of mental ill health in adults have their origins from being children. And of the 70% of children that we know do not come to anybody's attention in terms of intervention around mental health. Today, there was a report around the increase, a disturbing report about the increasing poor levels of mental health among young women in particular, and also of young men. But the cuts that the government have made meant that the CCG cut our community mental health provision by 43%, £745,000. So these are the kind of things that happen, because Liverpool, as Councillor Brant said, isn't just affected by reductions in funding in health, it's in police, it's in schools, and it's also in our council. So this, we should write to the Minister of Health, because it's his responsibility, he's in government, the same with the Chancellor of the Exchequer. And we should never forget the role that the Lib Dems have played in this either. But if we want action, I think that really the only thing that we can expect really to happen is that we get rid of this government and we have a Labour Party and a Labour government led by Jeremy Corbyn that will end these funding cuts and bring the money back to the city that it should duly have.
It's not a deletion. So I think it's consistent.
to support the amendment, even if I actually have to say I'd be quite happy if one was dropped and three was dropped. Two is the critical punchline. But the two are contradictory, the two are compatible. And I would recall that the last time there was a considerable increase in spending on health service in this region, we actually didn't get a considerable output because a lot was spent on the management of the health service rather than delivery of service. And so spending isn't the only answer. And we are supposed to be supporting devolution and hopefully greater devolution.
Okay, I'm going to call Councillor Beaumont and then I want to call Councillor Brant to reply, and at that point he'll explain whether he's going to accept the addendum or not, and then we move to the vote after that point. Okay, Councillor Beaumont.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'm speaking against the motion because the amendment, because the actual motion itself is about one topic, the amendment is about something completely different. The actual motion is about how we have missed out on funding across the board. The amendment is about fundamental and significant change in governance to health services in the city. We should not conflate the two topics. They should be kept separate and be debated separately. I hope that we can support the provisional motion as it stands, simply put as a statement on where things are going wrong at the moment in terms of our funding inadequacies. There may well be a time to discuss the governance mechanisms for the health services on Merseyside. I don't think this debate is it. And also, if Councillor Kemp or indeed anybody attends the Health and Wellbeing Board meetings, you'll know, you'll find out for yourselves exactly how seriously we consider and discuss the quality of healthcare in this city. And the board is chaired by the Mayor, and we go into great detail about the different ways we can improve healthcare in the city, even with the funding problems that we have. I'd also very briefly like to draw Council's attention to, in the original motion, the point that's made about the reductions in funding, and indeed Councillor Kemp did refer to himself in public health funding and how that particularly is disadvantages us in this city, and how that, more than anything, from my point of view, is something that needs to be corrected urgently. In fact, this week, as councillors will be aware, we are having within the city a campaign which we are working with a number of other stakeholders about people knowing their own numbers, knowing their own blood pressure. And so I'm taking this opportunity as a shameless plug for this, because it is a vital issue. 49,000 people in this city at this moment have high blood pressure but don't know it. And those 49,000 people will manifest very significant poor health outcomes unless that is addressed. So I would urge everybody here to tell everybody they know to go to the doctor and make sure that you know your numbers. Equally, at the Health and Wellbeing Board, we have just signed up to the Local Authority Declaration on Healthy Weight. In actual fact, 105,000 adults in this city have a problem with health related to weight. And these are the things that we are tackling now. This is what we need to continue tackling. And we would be able to do a much better job if we had the money to do it.
So, Councillor Brown, first question, are you accepting the...
I'm not, Lord Mayor. I'll explain why. Although there is much to be commended in the motion, I should say first of all, we welcome the Liberal Democrats' late conversion to devolution, because I seem to remember that they campaigned long and hard against the devolution package, and the direct elected mayor here that were part of a similar process in Greater Manchester. But there are two problems with the amendment. The first is, three problems. The first is it's actually incorrect when it says that England's best strategic transformation plan is in Manchester. In fact, there are four which are regarded as outstanding by the NHS, and Greater Manchester isn't one of them. But secondly, I'd like to echo the comments of the Greens. Actually, we on this side of the chamber do not believe that the strategic transformation plans, the STPs, are an appropriate vehicle to be commended in any way. They've been done with little if no consultation between the SDP process and local authorities, and they are being used nationally as an attempt to smuggle through cuts. That is the reason why we have set our face against SDPs, and they were rejected unanimously at the Liverpool Health and Wellbeing Board. And the content of this amendment appears to suggest that they are commendable and that we should emulate one that's deemed to be wrongly described as the best in this motion. Finally, there is an issue about the final paragraph of the Greater Manchester Model Recommendation 3. I think there is much to be commended with the Greater Manchester Model, and I would indeed like to see a devolution of NHS decision-making down to a local level. But what I will say is that there are problems with the Greater Manchester Model, as the Lib Dems may not know. It is chaired by an NHS England appointee, John Rouse, a very commendable individual, but my view is that it should be under locally elected control and supervision.
I wonder if Councillor Brant would just give way, because what he said is actually incorrect. John Rouse is the chief executive chair, is Lord Peter Smith.
Are you giving way?
I'm quite
laugh by that, although I don't think that the NHS England appointment is the right way of devolving that down power and responsibility, because in reality the threat of control stretched back to Whitehall in a way in Manchester that if we are to have devolution here, I would not like to see replicated rules. So for those reasons, Lord Mayor, particularly the issue about strategic transformation plans, are not able to accept the amendment.
Right, so we move straight to the vote on the amendment, and ask for those in favour of the amendment. Those against the amendment, I think that's overwhelming. So the amendment and addendum is defeated. Can we move on to a vote on the substantive motion? Those in favour? All in favour of the motion? Agreed? Carried. Let's move on. Job centre location proposals. Councillor Cushnell, Walker, Sharon Ross, what are the names here? Who's moving, who's seconding?
Councillor Ross is moving the motion.
Councillor Ross moving and Councillor Cushnell seconding.
For giving me the opportunity to move this motion. As councillors are aware, we are losing 4 job centres across the city, 10% across the region. One of those falls within my constituents who I represent. Sorry. Some of you may think that I'm naive. And maybe I am, but to me, a job centre is somewhere where someone can go for support in finding employment. I got here a letter from Peter Jameson, who is the director for the region, for the DWP. And from the information in this letter, it's totally contradictory to any support for employment for our communities. Despite promises to both Councillor Cushnell and Lara Orr that they would work closely with the communities. To date, Norris Green Job Centre has closed. It closed on the 15th. No explanation as to why the closure date was brought forward. According to the letter, ministerial criteria has been met, including requirements for public consultation. The only criteria that I can see within the letter is that there was an online form, and for many of us here, we know that one of the biggest barriers that our vulnerable claimants face is not having access to online and also not having the skills. There's posters and leaflets have gone up in the job centres, and this is it for the public consultation. The DWP were invited to consultation with the community. I myself have attended numerous meetings. I've been out campaigning, I've been out round shops, getting support, making people aware, because there hasn't been a big splash about this, and it's so detrimental to the whole of our community. The letter also states that an equality impact assessment has been completed. This has not been shared, none has seen this equality impact assessment. But the DWP, and this is a quote, recognise that some claimants will be taking an unfamiliar journey, and in such instances, where coaches will provide support during this transitional period. What support are these where coaches going to give? Many of the people who attend the job centre in our screen are very, very vulnerable. With they're facing a round trip of 5 miles, there is no provision of funding to cover their travel costs, because unless they the only way they can claim any travel costs is, as things stand now, if it's outside of their normal signing on or when they normally attend. If you're unfortunate enough to be a sofa saver, you can have to attend the job centre 5 days a week. So again, financially, you just cannot do it. Also, you only need to arrive late, or even early, at a job centre to face sanctions. I don't know how they've assessed all this in this equality. In fact, they do not say whether the wear coaches will accompany these vulnerable people. Because for some people with mental health issues, actually getting onto a bus is so traumatic. Are these wear coaches going to go hand in hand with them? Are they going to meet them at their home? Are they going to take them? How are they going to support these people? Or is it just when you can get the 14 bus? Excuse me. Claimants can request that they attend a job centre nearer to their home. However, with the closure of the non-screen job centre, the two alternative options have been Everton Road and Eaton Road, which again, they are the nearest, so you know that statement just blows itself apart. I've spoken about the if you have no fixed abode and your things. The proposal that was put forward, which is close to my heart, is that this did not need to happen. There was adequate space. As the job centre closed, there was 24 advisors or way coaches or whatever their name is. The 24 in that job centre. And provision that 30 desks have been made within the library. Our libraries are a hub. That is a community hub. To have our job centre in the library with access to good computer access, to access to learning within our libraries. We work very closely with all of the community organisations to support our claimants. It would all be under one roof. The one-stop shop is there. The support network around that area, around that hub, is tremendous. I speak strongly for communities working with the DWP. I wouldn't be standing here today if it wasn't a community organisation and a local job centre advisor that gave me an opportunity to go on a course to improve my confidence and start on a future jobs fund, which did lead to full-time employment. I started this speech by saying I may be naive. I'm finishing it by thinking, am I being cynical? To me, the offer that was made, why would anybody turn it down? And I'd like to finish by saying that maybe I am cynical, but is the local approach too much support? By turning down this offer, it's attacking the most vulnerable in our society, or showing a total disregard for community partnerships. Is the offer too good? Is that why they refused it?